Morning routine is fundamentally important right now. The victory hour that I talk about in the 5 a.m. club, this will help you so much right now. 5 to 6 a.m., the 20-20-20 formula that I explained. Morning exercise, morning meditation, morning journaling. Hydration, which means drinking lots of water. You know, and to have a strong morning routine, you need a really ironclad pre-sleep ritual. Now is the time you want even more sleep. You want to build up and fortify your immune system. Get more sleep. Have lots of water. Get lots of vitamin D, which includes sunshine. Get lots of vitamin C. Meditation, powerful. I'd also say this is a great time for you to, rather than retract, ask yourself, how can you build your skills? Read more books, watch more podcasts, learn more, bring more value to your business, bring more value to your teammates, bring more value to your marketplace where so many people are shrinking, and bring more value to the world. So if you look at the great leaders of humanity, these are people, their leadership was forged when the world was falling apart. And I would ask you and encourage you to ask yourself, how can you shift from victimhood right now to leadership?
Right now, I am surrounded with sanitizer. I'm sure you guys are as well. What's up, Stockholm and Calgary, Canada? State of an emergency issued yesterday. Yeah, I totally hear you. Same here. for me, I'm actually not someone that panics about this sort of thing because I'm kind of the sort of person that loves to say, like, I can control everything. And at the same time, I can't control anything. And I find such bliss and beauty in that. And what I mean by that is right now, I can't control what's going on with the coronavirus. And neither can any of you guys. But we can control how we handle it and how we feel about it. And then how we pass that on to other people. Because if you're freaking out, then other people around you are going to be freaking out. So I'm always like, how can this be the best thing that's ever happened to us? And I mean that from a Tony Robbins said that. Someone's saying they just shut down the state of PA, but I work in a hospital. So, oh God, take care of yourself if you're in a hospital. so yeah, Tony Robbins says, how can you take the worst thing and make it the best thing possible? And so I think things like this really is just about framing and how we all see things. So right now, there's nothing I can do about the actual virus itself. So I'm going to push that out. I can't control it, but I can control how I feel and then how I respond and come on. So I'm just like, how can this be amazing? Okay, one, I get to do an IG live with you guys on like the random, what's today, Monday, at 2:30 in the afternoon. So I never would otherwise be able to do that with you guys if I wasn't from home. So that's one massive positive thing. Second thing is I don't get to see my husband as much. We keep running in and out, but I get to see him. So I want to ask you guys right now, how can this actually be the best thing that's ever happened to you? Let's stay positive. So that's how I'm seeing the situation.
What are you all doing to make use of this time? And I'm sure you've seen it, Sir Isaac Newton during a quarantine. That's when he developed calculus. Shakespeare wrote King Lear. So there's a lot we can do with this time, especially if this new home working situation is new to you. It's going to take a little bit of adjusting. In 2008, after the economic downturn and the housing crisis, it was an absolute boom for my career in photography, which you wouldn't have thought of it. And it wasn't obvious. Again, this is really when I tripled down on building the community that ultimately turned into the best camera app and Creative Live. I put out a lot of content because the number of jobs went down. So you're not quite sure what format it's going to take, and what got you to where you are now is probably not what's going to push you through into the next chapter as we enter these uncertain times. But I just want you to know that it's possible, and where there's a will, there's a way. Continue doing what you can to try and manage the downside.
So somebody said, Italy, are people working? And the answer is no. From what I understand, they're in complete lockdown. And someone's saying within 3 years from now, coronavirus will have been only a temporary blip. I think 3 years from now, what you're going to see is every year, there'll be people who have some version of the coronavirus now. It's here to stay, just like SARS is here to stay. Just like there was the Asian flu in 1957. people don't remember this, I don't remember it, but read about the Asian flu that happened in 1957, killed 34,000 people in the U.S., and still exists to this day. The economy went into a recession, but then when the recession was over, people, they stopped buying things for a little while, but then they buy more things when they come out of the recession. There's so much pent-up demand that the economy actually surges. So that's probably what will happen here. Nobody's buying now, but in a quarter or two, people will buy. But again, take a look at your anxiety or your fears and ask yourself, what is the fear about? Are you afraid you're going to run out of money? What is the worst case scenario? Are you afraid you're going to get sick? Because then you could look at the statistics for, you know, and then you could stay away from people. Where are you afraid family members will get sick? Are you afraid for your career or for your job? Are you afraid of going broke? Just what's the worst case scenario and really figure out what you could do about it. But also realize the worst case scenario almost never happens. Every time in my life that I've ever panicked and I thought, oh my God, this is going to happen. This is definitely going to happen. I'm going to lose all my money. I'm going to lose all my money and then they're going to throw me in jail for whatever reason. That's never happened. The worst case scenario has never happened. So understand what it is you're actually afraid of. Don't be angry. Don't be angry at this virus. Don't be angry at the Chinese or about politics. Look inside yourself and ask, what are you really afraid of? Are you afraid to get sick? There are things to do. Are you afraid you're going to lose all your money? There are things to do. But analyze it and be honest about what you're really afraid of. Fear is biological. When things are uncertain, it's important to realize that fear happens for biological reasons. Our ancestors, if they passed by a tree that rustled in the wind, they would run. They wouldn't step around. They wouldn't wait and see, oh my gosh, what's causing this tree to rustle? They would run automatically because they would be afraid automatically. The ancestors who stopped and said, well, why did this tree leaves rustle? They got eaten by lions. That's why they're not our ancestors. So our fear and our anxiety is a natural reaction to all this uncertainty, this scary uncertainty with the coronavirus that's happening. The likelihood is you're not going to die from it. Very few people as a percentage are going to die from this, like every other disease out there. And the likelihood is also you're going to be exposed. No matter what you do, you're going to be exposed to the disease and you'll either have not get it or you'll have no symptoms or you'll have few symptoms and then you'll recover. I mean, in some populations, people over 70 are the most at risk, so those people should stay home, whatever. But anyway, label your fear. What are you afraid of? Look at the worst case scenario, analyze it. You have to there's evidence that taking good care of yourself is really important. So you have to sleep well, sleep 8 hours a day. If you don't want to get this disease, I have to not do my usual junk food binges or whatever. If I don't want to get this, stay in some shape. Like if you want to run, do cardio, because that not only does that keep you healthy, but it's a natural antidepressant. So that will help relieve anxiety. And in general, This is going to sound not as intuitive, but do something creative today, because that's a way of putting yourself in flow and it absorbs you in the thing you're creating. You know, write down 10 ideas, draw, write a story, just even write a diary entry, how you're feeling right now, or do something creative, because that also is a lot of evidence. It relieves anxiety when you're in this kind of flow state.
I have investments already. And I have someone managing my money, and he said, unless you need the money now, it's best just to hold on to those investments and then wait this out. Do you think she should buy or sell?
I think this person gave you really great advice. That's really good advice. I think that you should just hold on because, you know, selling in a panic is probably the silliest thing you could ever do. And I'm not saying that because I'm not going to tell you what, I think the market goes, and by the way, I think the market goes lower from here. I think it goes down to the 10 to 20% from here. Okay? I do. I don't know that for a fact, but I do. But still, you know, to be selling because of a panic, you have to be a long-term play here. You should be, and hopefully your money manager sounds like he's got his head screwed on straight, or she has a head screwed on straight, and, you know, you're not going to buy something or sell something on any given day because of what's happening with coronavirus. Right? You want to take a longer term horizon on your investments than that. If you want to play that timing game of getting in and getting out, I mean, it's very, very difficult, all right?
The thing that I did with my team that I highly recommend those of you who have families and those of you who have teams is, number one, let them know that their safety is your number one priority. Their mental safety, emotional safety, physical safety, financial safety is your number one concern. That's one. Number two, reiterate that in times like this, in times of chaos, fear, uncertainty, volatility, and everything in between, the people who stick together win together. We need each other. As much as people think, well, I don't need you and you don't need me. Oh, yes, I do. Oh, yes, you do. And when things are going great, it's easy to go, don't need you. You don't need me. But you know what? The human species is a species that bonds. It's a species that wants connection. I mean, look, why are you on here right now? You want to connect, hear, listen, share. And so we do need each other. And I'm starting to look like Bernie Sanders now. We do need each other. And when we do this, I like Bernie. I want to assure them that their safety as the CEO of the company is my concern, and that they can come to me with any challenge issue that they have.
My wife's brothers are young. They're 23 years old. They're like, oh, everybody's over-exaggerating. It's no big deal. The virus isn't that bad. Here's the thing. It doesn't matter if the virus is like a flu. It's a pandemic. This is real. Businesses are shutting down. The stock market crashed, and it's going to fluctuate up and down. We might be at the beginning of a recession. It could go to a depression, or maybe it's just a blip. But here's the thing. It is here. It is real. And the difference of us getting through this as an individual and as a society depends on, I believe, someone just wrote opportunity. I agree. But it depends on what's going on between here. So that's what I want to talk about today. What if we took a different perspective? What if we decided today that we were going to become role models and leaders and be an example of how to get through this? Now, I want to back up. So the only way I can help with what's currently going on is to talk about the past. So I am 51. I've been self-employed since I was 17 years old, cutting firewood. I've been blessed to start lots of companies, but that's how I started, cutting firewood, fixing wrecked cars, right? So I was a part of the crash in the late 80s. I was a part of the crash in 2007, the shift, the crash in the economy. I was also a part of 9/11. And this to me, and I think this is the best way I can send in love. I see everybody, I'm going to try not to look down. Patty, sending love to everyone. I'm sending love too. That was a great message. But let me just share what I believe from history. 9/11 was the most similar to this, okay? It was one day the world changed, right? Especially here in America, no matter where you are from around the world, in America, in one day, we lost sense of security. America's felt like, you know, we've never really been attacked by outside forces. Just Pearl Harbor once, right? America hasn't been in wars. We've been protected. We've been shielded. All of a sudden, we were attacked on our home land. Thousands of people died. Overnight, the world changed. The economy shifted. The world shifted. And everybody was afraid to go to, like, I remember not wanting to go to a basketball game, not wanting to go to the mall. Like, if you're super young, you barely remember. If obviously you're over 35, you remember. But it was scary. Like, things change. And to the far right, people are like, the world will never be the same, especially America is ruined. To the far left, it was like, no big deal. I don't mean left and right, like liberal and conservative, just shifted, right? But here's the thing. During that chaos, what happened is what will happen here. People stepped up. Role models came into play. Leaders came into play and inspired people to come out of their shells, inspired people to get back into the world, inspired people to action, inspired their kids, their family, their friends. And slowly, especially here in the United States, slowly we gained our confidence. And then it compounded, and now it's like, oh yeah, the 9/11 thing. It was tragic for so many people, but it was a part of our history. And that's what I want to encourage you today. When you look throughout time, no matter if you're 20, 30, 40, 50, or 60, or older, remember this. Just like seasons, right? It goes from spring and to summer and summer into fall and fall into winter. Our world is secular, goes in cycles. We've had summer for a long time. It's been beautiful. It's been the best economy in the world for the last 10 years. It's been like, oh, this is perfect. But winter came really fast. Now, I don't know how long winter is going to last. I'm not an economist. I'm not going to tell you how long this will be down. But here's what I know. Winter is here at this moment. It could be the start of a recession, or it could be a blip. But the difference in your family, the difference for you is going to be your perception of this situation. See, it might hit you. Okay, I'm going to back up. So many people, I've had a couple people say, man, it's not going to affect my industry. This is going to affect everyone. Let me just tell you, it's going to affect everyone. Some people in a massively positive way and some people in a negative way. If you are in the information business, if you're on the in the online world, if you're part of the digital economy, if you're selling knowledge, if you're part of the knowledge industry, in my opinion and in my experience, when things like this happen, people want to learn more specialized knowledge from home online. If you're in that industry, step into it. You have the opportunity to excel and help people, right? But other industries are going to be hurt. So just know there's going to be repercussions. But you know who comes out on top? Not the person who invents something, not the person who takes advantage of people during times like this. You know who takes wins? Is those that can find a mindset to be a role model and a leader during these times.
If you want more advice, wisdom, guidance from other successful entrepreneurs on how you can navigate the coronavirus situation, check out the video right there next to me. I hope you find it valuable. Continue to believe, and I'll see you there.
The whole issue of using your hands touching your face that people all concentrate on,